CIUT 89.5, Toronto.
The views and opinions expressed on the following program are those of the producers and or the persons appearing on the program and do not necessarily reflect the views and opinions of CIUT-FM.
Hi, I'm Mark Tara, producer and host of Rainbow Country.
Hi, this is Donna G from The More the Merrier.
Hi, this is Daniel Garber the Movies for CIUT Critic Circle, and this is CIUT at TIFF 2022.
Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the 47th edition of the Toronto International Film Festival. I am so glad to be here with you again.
Thank you so much for being with us tonight. I can't wait to get us started.
Hello, Canada! Hello!
This is astonishing.
First, I want to say I'm really glad we came to Toronto.
Hi, I'm Taylor.
What an incredible honor it is to kick off the festival with our film.
So excited to be home and to be showing this film in the place it was made.
Saturday night, this is great.
I have imagined this moment, I think, pretty much my whole life.
This film is for the risk takers. I love you too.
Thank you for everyone at TIFF. I've missed you guys so much. There is no audiences in the world like Toronto. And it's so, I'm so happy to be back.
Can I be invited to beer?
I'm so filled with a lot of emotions.
My heart is full. I cannot say any words. I cannot even explain.
There are so many things you could have been doing on a Monday night, but you're here to watch our big little film that could.
I am finding myself very moved and humbled, to say the least.
Love you, Toronto. Love you, Tim.
I do have to thank TIFF for your commitment to the art of filmmaking. Thank you, Share Her Journey, for your work championing women's causes. And thank you for this groundbreaker award.
I want to just acknowledge all the people who work on this festival and how hard they work to make it happen and the dreams that they give to people.
First of all, I think you're the greatest audience in the world.
Seeing it with you means so much to us.
Being able to bond with everybody, this is what it's about. It's the human experience, you know. It's really the people that you have these experiences with that makes them so fulfilling and rich.
It's the audience that gives cinema life. So I must thank you for keeping me in the job that I love, because it's nice work if you can get it.
Hi, this is Daniel Garber the Movies to welcome you to episode 3 of CIUT at TIFF 2022. On today's show, we'll hear from Donna G in an excerpt from her latest interview with South African director John Barker about his new film, The Umbrella Man. Mark Tara will be talking with Vera Drew about her controversial film, The People's Joker. And I'll be here too, interviewing Sam Soko and Lauren deFilippo about their fascinating documentary, Free Money. But first, here are my observations of TIFF this year. You could say it was the best of TIFFs, it was the worst of TIFFs. There's a huge emphasis on movie stars and Oscar bait films this year. I saw hundreds of fans swarming King Street, literally climbing walls to catch a glimpse of celebs like Taylor Swift, Harry Styles, Oprah Winfrey, and Hillary Clinton. For movie lovers, there were a lot of good movies too, including a number of world premieres, and the audiences did go wild, giving long standing ovations to movies like The Fabelmans, Steven Spielberg's autobiographical coming-of-age story, which won the People's Choice Award, and Rian Johnson's Knives Out sequel, Glass Onion, and Sarah Polley's Women Talking, based on a Miriam Taves novel, among many others. What I missed, though, were the amazing yet seldom seen international films from countries like Holland, Hungary, Poland, Romania, Russia, China, Japan, Turkey, Chile, Israel, Chile, Argentina, West Africa, and Italy. While there were some of these, there were nearly as many as usual. And yeah, I know there's a war going on. I know it's a pandemic and the economy and things like that. It just, the balance between indie art films and big Hollywood films felt a little bit off. I did see a hell of a lot of movies this year, between 45 and 50 in all, including some I really liked and haven't even talked about yet. Like Bones of Crows, an epic story of the life of a Cree woman. The powerful Danish drama Unruly, about a young woman in the 1930s locked up in an island home for the mentally disabled just because she liked drinking and having sex. The Hummingbird is a fascinatingly twisted story about the life of a man in Florence. Aristotle and Dante Discover the Meaning of the Universe, a tender coming-of-age story set in El Paso, Texas, and All the Beauty and the Bloodshed, an amazing documentary on artist Nan Golden and her fight with the philanthropist Sackler family, who also happened to bring us the opiate crisis. You want to hear something funny? All those five movies I just mentioned, those great movies, they were all directed by women. Remember those. In the end, it was the excitement, the crowds, the international audiences, the great movies, and the all-around enthusiasm that gave Toronto a certain buzz, a kind of glow all around you that you don't always see here. And that's what made TIFF a really memorable 10 days.
Hi, I'm Mayor John Tory, and you're listening to CIUT 89.5 FM. I'm old enough to remember when they called it U of T Radio.
Coming up next, Mark Tarr will be talking with Vera Drew, whose film The People's Joker got pulled from the festival for legal reasons. Mark was there before it was canceled, so keep listening for this exclusive interview.
Where are you?
Back in Arkham.
Some people call me the space cowboy.
Why don't you tell me a little bit about how you've been feeling lately?
Was I born in the wrong body?
What do you see?
Some call me the gangster of love.
Crane.
Ash, little one. You'll be mama's happy little boy in no time.
As far back as I could remember, I always wanted to be a Joker.
How are you settling into the city?
Things are great. I've met a ton of great people, ton of friends.
Have you found work?
I'm pursuing a career in stand-up comedy.
I'm gonna be a comedian! Hey, screw you, Bane.
Here's a pro tip. A lot of good comedy comes from stuff that actually happens to you. It gets good laughs.
I always thought my life was kind of a tragedy.
You were mentally ill. I got you help.
You were mentally ill. I'm mentally ill. You were mentally ill.
And, it is.
Let's give a warm round of applause for Joker the Harlequin.
Not Shadow Band Short Ribs.
I'm not going to teach you how to be funny today. I'm going to teach you how to be honest.
Vera, hi. How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
I am well. I have to say thank you for being here, to have your voice, your story be heard by the LGBT community and beyond. So thank you for that, especially to talk about The People's Joker. The People's Joker, an illegal queer coming-of-age comic book movie, a movie that you wrote, you directed. Talk to me about the story that you're telling within this movie. What's the story that you're telling in The People's Joker?
Sure, yeah. It's the movie's very autobiographical. It's about, you know, the log line is it's about an unfunny transgender clown who is named Joker and is addicted to a drug called Smilex, and she finds herself and finds love all while starting an illegal comedy theater in Gotham City and facing off against a familiar caped crusader. So that's kind of the surface level like synopsis, but within that, it really is kind of like this autobiographical story for me, you know, very loosely based off of my experiences as a trans woman working in comedy and coming from the Midwest and all that stuff. Kind of taking all these characters that I definitely don't own any of the rights to. I'm not sure how this movie's playing at TIFF, but it is. So they can't take it back now. But yeah, really transposing my experience onto them.
So to me, this movie is a multimedia experience. You have live action, you have animation, you have music. So what inspired you to make The People's Joker? Where did the idea, the concept for this movie come from?
It was something I was kicking around. I had a version of this a few years ago that was really just a handful of like journals that I had written, kind of processing the last decade of my life. You know, I jokingly say that I'm the transgender Forrest Gump of alternative comedy, just because I've been involved or like have worked on a lot of like really amazing groundbreaking comedy television in the last 10 years. Like I've been really lucky. I worked on Nathan For You and Eric Andre, and I came up under Tim and Eric and worked with Sacha Baron Cohen and stuff. And I've really been around and have been really fortunate to work with a lot of cool people. I needed to like really, just needed to like kind of like reflect on all that in a lot of ways. So I don't know that I was necessarily gearing up to make my first film, but I was gearing up to make a pretty long-term project that was going to be about comedy, gender, and confronting like ancestral trauma and where that all kind of can intersect. And it was right at the start of the pandemic. My friend Bree dared me to re-edit Todd Phillips' Joker. Well, it wasn't a dare. She commissioned it, actually. It was like an art commission. It was the only time I've ever gotten an art commission, which made me feel special, but it is my friend, so maybe it doesn't really count. But that's where the project really stemmed from then, is, you know, I was really earnestly trying to make, at first, an experimental found footage film that was going to use Batman Forever and Joker 2019 and sort of use all that footage to tell a new story. And I don't know what I was going to do, but it was impossible and it was going to require me using a lot of footage that I didn't own the rights to. So yeah, I mean, I sat down with Bree and I kind of was like, you know, I really actually think I want to do this. Like I'm sitting here adding fart sound effects to Joaquin Phoenix and kind of realizing that like, maybe I do think of Joker and Harley Quinn and like Batman and stuff as like mythic characters that, you know, you can kind of really genuinely explore queer themes and themes of identity in. And Bree was totally on board because, like me, you know, the pandemic had just started. We were both unemployed, didn't know what to do. So yeah, I mean, that was really also kind of, that was all to say, where the mixed media approach came in was we wrote this script and what we wrote is basically what we shot. I mean, there was a handful of improv and stuff we like found along the way.
Did you do the animation in the movie?
What's that?
Did you do the animation in the movie?
That's what I was getting at. I did some of it. Like, but if we really we opened up the creative process to anybody that wanted to participate. And I had a web series at the time called Hot Topics that I announced this on. And it was like the only time, and I mean, we didn't go like crazy viral, but I went like soft viral. And, you know, we just put this message out there that was like, if, you know, we're making a queer Joker movie and we need artists and animators and filmmakers who like want to contribute. If you just want to make like a cool, fun, weird Batman movie with us, hit us up. And we had the most overwhelming response I could have ever imagined. Like it's crazy. Like over 200 people were just interested. in working on it, and that's like about how many we ended up working with, from all over the world, artists and animators and illustrators and musicians and, you know, and from all different disciplines. You know, like I wear a lot of hats. Like I do VFX and like I come from animation too. Like it's what I studied, but every discipline is in this movie. We have stop motion and 3D environments and 2D hand drawn. You know, like it really, the list goes on, and
it's a multimedia experience.
Exactly. Yeah.
So you just said you have a background in visual effects and animation, in film production, in music video production. How did you get into film in the first place?
It's, you know, I knew, I don't know, because I wanted to make movies since I was awake, you know, like since I could remember, I wanted to make movies. I knew I was a filmmaker before I knew I was a girl. This is my first feature film, but I almost feel like I came into my identity as a filmmaker and as just an artist in general before ever really figuring out who the fuck I was. And like, I look back at a body of work that is pretty niche and pretty like weird and, but like cool. And there's like stuff in there where I watch it now and I'm like, God, I'm so trans. I am so gay. And like, it was all there. It was all there in my art. In my art was very like aggressively queer, but I didn't have that language for myself, and I also just wasn't comfortable with it. So, you know, like I really film, you know, I grew up in the Midwest, so and being as gay and as trans as I am, it was only inevitable that I become an artist. Like it really is. Like I don't know that I really discovered filmmaking or anything. It really was just like, you know, my parents had a video camera. It was there and I needed to survive. And the only place where I really knew how to like safely explore myself growing up was holding a video camera or doing sketch comedy and improv or drag. But yeah.
And now here we are in 2022 with your debut feature, The People's Joker. Yeah. Okay. 2018, you received an Emmy nomination for your editing work on Showtime's Who is America?
Yes.
Talk to me about what went through your mind the moment you found out that you got an Emmy nomination. 2018, the moment you got that notification, what goes through your mind?
I found out actually like the morning, it was either like the day after or the morning of. It was like basically like a day after I had gotten like surgery. I Adam's apple shaved down. And so like I got a notification and somebody sent me an article saying that we got nominated. And I didn't believe it for like 48 hours. I just thought I was in some sort of weird like post anesthesia delusion or something. Because I don't know. I mean, it's the same way I feel about getting the movie getting into TIFF. Like, I was just talking to Brie about it. Like, it feels like we snuck in or something. Like, it's like, I don't know. Like, I'm from the middle of nowhere, raised by two people that you've never heard of. And, like, I just never thought of people like me getting to go to, like, Emmys or film festivals and stuff. And, yeah, it was sick. I mean, like, I would have loved to have won, but, like, even not winning was kind of cool because, like, you know, we didn't win, so we didn't have to speak. And
but you got nominated.
Yeah, we got nominated, and then we got to just dance and, like, have fun in, like, an open bar. Like, it was one of the few times, like, working in this industry, too, that I really did feel like, ooh, like, Hollywood, you know? Like, normally
and
I'm
you,
just, like,
and you were seen. You were seen. And I think that that's the most important aspect.
Yeah. And it was my first time because my name change coincided with my Emmy nomination. Mm-hmm. And it was like kind of this moment of like, really like, okay, this is who I am. Like, I'm not that like shy, weird, sweaty boy that's just sitting in the editing bay. I'm a beautiful goth princess who gets nominated for Emmys.
I have two questions left for you and just a handful of minutes. You are part of the LGBT community. You are trans. I believe you came out in your early 20s. Talk to me about what led you to come out in your early 20s.
I actually came out when I was 28. And really it was just
that's early-ish.
Yeah, it's early-ish. You know what? The lead up to that, my 20s felt so long, by the way. Like, it was a dark time for me. Like, I was, you know, my movie talks about it, you know, pretty metaphorically, but like I had a drug problem that was pretty rough, and like I was not a happy person. And it's weird because like coming out really wasn't, it wasn't like I didn't have like these moments, a big moment of realization. It really was just I had tried on every single identity at that point. Like I had really tried everything, and I had done, you know, I was prescribed and medicated crazy drugs and like diagnosis everything under the sun, and like it really was just kind of like I ruled out every other possibility, and it was just like, oh, I'm trans. And yeah, I mean, like I didn't really have the support system around me when it started, and I think, you know, that's pretty clear from the movie. Like I didn't really have, but I think none of us really do. I do think, like, on some level, the coming out process is a death for queer people. And you do experience loss no matter what. And it for me, it wasn't necessarily a bad thing. It really it helped me kind of recalibrate and move towards just the things that allow me to be authentic. I don't know. Was that a good answer? I never know how to answer.
Yes, yes. Okay, so my last question for you. Yeah. The People's Joker, live action, animation, music. There's even an animated erotic scene in the movie.
Yeah.
What do you hope audiences come away with after they've seen your debut feature, The People's Joker?
Well, I don't know. I mean, it's a tough question because like I never really set out to like, the movie doesn't have like a one message beyond just like be yourself, you know. Like I really do feel like the movie is kind of simple in a lot of ways, where like it really is just about being true to yourself and leaning into authenticity and pushing through fear, because on the other side of fear there usually is authenticity and love and stuff. And you know, I hope people can take that away from it. I hope people can see that, like, the trans experience goes beyond just, like, fucking conservative talking points, and, like, also goes beyond, like, just woke scolding and, you know, like, it's very unique. There's not a one-size-fits-all approach to any queer person's life. But within that specificity, I hope people can see that, like, you know, my experience growing up and figuring out who I was isn't that different than you know, a cis person's. And I hope people, too, can see, like, genre films, you know, are a place where you can explore these things. Like, if we are just now living in a culture where all we make are superhero movies, like, we can make superhero movies like this. Like, you can make soft, queer superhero movies. Like, anybody can do it. And like, genre is the perfect place, actually, to unpack themes, because genre allows you to really utilize fiction and myth to its fullest potential. Mm.
Well said, well said. Vera Drew, I have to say thank you so much for your time. Well said, well done, and well made.
Thank you, Mark.
My name is Charles Officer, and I'm the writer and director of Invisible Essence, The Little Prince on CIUT 89.5 FM.
Don't touch that dial. Coming up next is an excerpt from Donna G's interview with South African director John Barker about his new dramatic thriller, The Umbrella Man, which premiered at TIFF 22.
Yeah, so it's set in Cape Town, and it's set in the Cape Malay community of Cape Town, which is predominantly in the Boer Kaap area, which used to be the slave quarters. And in the history of Cape Town, there was another suburb in Cape Town called District 6, D6, which was again, the same thing you say, is it was a melting pot of different cultures, black people, white people, Jewish people, Muslim, from all walks of life, all living together. And it irked the apartheid government, because the apartheid government saw that as the worst possible scenario, having different cultures living harmoniously together. So they unfortunately kicked out all the inhabitants, and they sent them to all four corners of Cape Town, and they bulldozed the once really beautiful bohemian suburb of D6. So a lot of those residents fled and hid in the Boer Kaap, which is more higher up on the mountain, which is the slave areas. And they survived living out there, and they continued to keep the culture of singing as minstrels. They kept that going all through apartheid. And so I just really wanted to highlight, to focus on a community that survived for so long and that managed to preserve the cultural elements that are so important to them.
And it's a beautiful area that you're shooting in. How familiar were you with that area before this film?
Very. I mean, the minstrels are a big part of South Africa. My father was a soccer coach, and he was coaching in mostly black townships. He was coaching AmaZulu in the 70s, and his team got into a final in Cape Town. So we drove down to Cape Town, and he drove us. My dad was an anti-apartheid activist, and so he drove us to District 6 to show us what was going on there. And it was terrible. It was apocalyptic scenes where it looked like it was the Second World War, where like cities had been bombed because it was half pulled down buildings and kids still playing in the streets while bulldozers were knocking down buildings in the background. And so that kind of always stayed with me. And then on top of that, my parents took me to see the minstrels perform when I was really young, and I was completely fascinated by that. So I always wanted to make a film about that community. And the strange thing is it's such a beautifully rich community that has so many amazing facets to it, especially music, which they used as a way of fighting the colonial masters. And there's been so few films made about that community. And most of the films tend to focus on the negative side of that community. They tend to focus on gangsterism and those kind of things, and prison films. But there's so many beautiful elements to that community that aren't gangster related. So I just was always inspired to make a film about the good aspects of that community.
Is the Boer Kaap in danger of being lost like the rest of District 6?
Yes, very much. Gentrification is a huge part of what's happening in Boer Kaap at the moment, because, you know, there's big business and corporates arrive and show people decent amounts of money to buy their lifelong, you know, thing, something that's been in their families for hundreds of years. And people are desperate, so they sell their houses, and those places are knocked down and replaced by, you know, skyscrapers. And that's happening all the time with the Boer Kaap. So it's a huge thing of how do the local people hold on to their birthrights, you know, to something that's been in their families forever. And they're tempted by money. And so people are selling up, and they, you know, so it's a crazy situation.
It's actually a worldwide situation that's happening with gentrification, where predominantly, I would say, neighborhoods where people of color lived and developed culture and community. But there's also, you know, elements of poverty. And so they're put in this situation where they're being offered money,
which will you know make their lives better, but it changes the culture.
It changes the cultural
makeup of the area.
Yeah.
And it's lost. Now, you mentioned the minstrels. For people who are listening here in Toronto, our side, we're more used to it being called carnival.
Yeah, I mean, the things that you mentioned now with New Orleans and obviously with Rio and anywhere where there was a community of slaves. It's very similar to what happened in Cape Town, because it was a thing that brought everyone together. And there's such a weird connection with America, with the minstrels, because the slaves were emancipated in 1840s in Cape Town. And just prior to that, there was a ship that had come over from the States, obviously a whole lot of white sailors, you know, doing blackface, and for some weird reason, the slaves took it on, obviously the inverse of that, and then painted their faces white and celebrated being minstrels when they were freed, and they took to the streets dressed as minstrels. So, you know, there was that. And then obviously the cool thing about the minstrels is they would sing songs. The colonial masters wouldn't understand what they were saying, because they would sing in Afrikaans, which is a language which is now really, really gaining credibility. But in those days, they would sing songs that would take the mickey out of, or take fun or poke fun at the colonial masters. And it was the one time when they could do that. And it's just such a key thing to that community, that even, you know, it was weird because of whoever was the colonial master at the time, whether it was Holland or was the Dutch or the English, it would go back and forth. And at some stage they were freed, and then their freedom was taken away, and then apartheid happened. And even through apartheid, this community and the minstrels continued to thrive and to keep this culture alive by using comedy and taking the mickey out of their masters all the time, which is also fascinating elements. And so it was key for us when we were making the film that we were true to all of those elements, and that we did justice to what those people had gone through apartheid and through slavery.
Did you have any locals assist you with the carnival elements?
Yeah, it was key. It was very important that we had all of our HODs were black. All of our HODs were from the community, and that lent a lot of authenticity to the project. Obviously, you know, I'm an old white guy, so I'm very much not part of that community, but we did everything we could in terms of the writing and in terms of making sure that the cast and the crew were all from the community.
You have a wonderful character named Aunt V.
Yes.
Tell me about that, Auntie Val. Tell me about that actress.
She's June Van Mert. She's absolutely amazing. She's tiny. She's petite. She's like 5 foot tall. And we were worried about there was a couple of scenes that were actually cut out of the film, but she was in the tunnels that exist under the castle. And in that car, it was crazy. We found a snake. There were cockroaches, there were rats, the smell was so foul down there. And I was really worried about June being stuck in the tunnels with us, but she was amazing. She was up and down the ladders all day. She's just like, she's got so much energy, and she was so brilliant to have in the film. She kept us all laughing, and she's just like, her energy is mad. She's an incredible woman. And initially when I wrote this like 14 years ago, Auntie V wasn't a big part of the film, but as time has gone by, we changed, because it was all guys at one stage. It was all men in the film. But luckily, we have really strong female characters. And Auntie V, being our matriarch, it was so beautiful that she came to light, and that she has such a big part in the film. So, yeah, she's crazy. She really is.
CIUT 89.5, Toronto.
Hi, what's your name?
My name's Kathy.
Hello, Kathy. What are you here on King Street for? Why are you here?
I am here standing in line with my daughter. I have a ticket for Causeway, the premiere, which I'm very excited to see. My daughter was not able to get a ticket, so I'm standing in the rush line for her where she's hoping to get a ticket.
Okay, so TIFF 2022, we're back, we're in person after 2 years of a pandemic. How are you feeling about that?
I am really excited. This is my first film festival. My daughter is in the film industry. She has a company that does events and premieres, and she invited me. So I love movies. I am so excited. I've already seen a number of phenomenal movies, and I have a number of phenomenal movies lined up to see in the next couple days. So before I go back to my real life, I'm just thrilled to be here.
Any movies that you've seen so far stand out to you that have made an impression on you? Anything comes to mind?
Yes, we saw Emily. Phenomenal. I know a little bit about Emily Bronte's story, but learned a lot more. Very interesting. Saw The Woman King, and just powerhouse action dynamic. Saw Bros, and Bros is a phenomenal movie. You will laugh, you will cry, and I'll recommend everything I've seen so far.
Last question for you. What does TIFF mean to you?
TIFF means an opportunity for people to come together, celebrate films, and for people in the film industry to showcase their talent, a place for new emerging filmmakers to come and make a name for themselves, people that wouldn't be known to get picked up by other studios. It's just a phenomenal opportunity for anyone who loves film, works in film, or is interested in film.
Amazing. Well said. Well done. Thanks for your time.
Yes, thank you.
Good evening, everyone. How are you? Good evening and welcome.
Coming up next, Sam Soko and Lauren deFilippo about their fascinating documentary, Free Money. Hi, this is Daniel Garber of the Movies for CulturalMining.com and CIUT 89.5 FM. In a poor East African village in Kenya, some of the kids there can't afford schooling while others have a bleak future ahead of them. Various foreign NGOs have come and gone over the years, leaving poverty and disappointment in their wake. But the latest one tries a different tact. They're offering a monthly stipend paid to all adult members of the village for over a decade to see if this can transform their lives. But what's the catch? And what do they mean by free money? Free Money is a new documentary that looks at the effects of UBI, Universal Basic Income, on the people who receive it and those who don't. The film was made over many years tracing changes in the villagers, concentrating on the lives of three of them. The film is directed by two award-winning documentarians. Lauren deFilippo's film, acclaimed doc Ailey, played theatrically in Toronto and across North America. Nairobi-based Sam Soko's film, Softy, was a big hit at Toronto's Hot Docs Documentary Film Festival. Free Money had its world premiere at TIFF, and I'm very pleased to have Lauren and Sam here on site at TIFF to tell us more about Free Money. Hi, Sam.
Hi.
Hi, Lauren.
Hi.
Thanks so much for coming in.
Thanks for having us.
Thank you. Thank you for having us.
So, Lauren, where did you first hear about this program?
I first heard about GiveDirectly's experiment from a New York Times article. It was called The Future of Not Working, and it profiled this massive experiment that they were running really across Kenya. But it was presented in a really interesting way in that, it was this idea of UBI. This was back in about 2017. A lot of people are not familiar with UBI, Universal Basic Income. It was sort of just kind of brewing in like the corners of the internet. And it was really being talked about, particularly by Silicon Valley, as a potential way to get around this kind of AI-driven future we were all facing, where the robots take our jobs, and how will we all survive? And so this organization, GiveDirectly, was looking at a UBI, and they were testing it out in rural Kenya. And I thought that the contrast of that was very interesting to me, kind of this really innovative idea playing out in such a rural place, but also was I guess you could say, skeptical about experimenting on such a vast population of people living in poverty. So I was able to secure access to GiveDirectly and started filming as they rolled out their experiment in one village in particular called Kagutu. And quickly realized that this was, you know, something bigger than just a film about universal basic income, about an idea. It was really a character story of these people who were part of this experiment and were going to be impacted profoundly by it. And, you know, being a white Westerner, also knew that I was really out of my depth in kind of telling such an intimate story as I wanted to about a group of rural Kenyans, and particularly with being drawn to the kids in the village already, the teenagers. And so I started looking for someone who could collaborate on this with me and potentially co-direct. And I had heard about Sam Soko and his film Softy, and I reached out.
Yep.
And so, Sam, what happened next?
So Lauren reached out. It was at the point where we're in post-production with my last film, and then she told me about this idea and the experiment that was just kicking off. And I was extremely skeptical for so many reasons. And it took me a while to not only just think about it, but also essentially do my due diligence, primarily because Kenya has, and Africa has, a very checkered past and experience with non-governmental organizations. And a lot of people, they come with ill or sometimes good intentions, but there's so many unintended consequences of what they're doing. And whenever they realize it's not going their way, they just ship up, ship out, and leave the consequences that the things they've created, the problems they've created at play. And so a lot of us are hugely skeptical of NGOs. So the thought that there's an NGO, a New York-based NGO, coming to Kenya to just give free money is like, what? No, it's not a thing.
And some of the villagers called it dirty money.
Yeah.
What do they mean by that?
It's again, just inherently the past of people coming to say they want to help you creates a deep culture of fear, skepticism, and it's one of the interpretations you have with someone coming to be like, if someone shows up at your door and you're like, I want to give you $1,000 every month for 12 years, you'll be like, wait, what? And the way we're a deeply religious society, and in a lot of religions, it's the way you see it, that has to be devil's money. if it's only the devil who would be like, he want to trap you with that money. and for a lot of villages, like, you can't blame them. It's they've suffered a lot in the hands of do-gooders, in quotes. And so that's what they meant by dirty money.
So when the money started coming in, what were the initial major changes?
Overall, people were extremely happy. I think in a way they were kind of just shocked that it actually came through. You know, there's a scene in the film where they get that first transfer on their phones, and I think there's just this feeling of, oh my God, they actually delivered mm-hmm. on this thing that they told us that they promised. And, you know, I think for the village of Kagutu itself, the effects of the money have been very positive. People have really focused on school fees for their children in Kenya. Correct me if I'm wrong, but public education isn't really an option. You pay for school.
Yeah, like,
right?
A lot of people have to, even if some of the school might be free, but there's so much money that's needed to just, you know, books and other stuff that people need, and it becomes expensive. So them having a consistent level of income that allows them to take their kids to school, or at least support part of the fees that is needed for school, then just makes a big difference. So
one thing I'm curious about is the money was distributed equally to an 18-year-old or someone who's much older, and to women and men.
What effect did that have to social relationships within the village?
So initially, of course, there's incredible, because again, our society is also deeply patriarchal. So the men, the families rely on the men to bring in bread and, you know, pay for stuff. So this money offered the opportunity for a lot of women for the first time to have a consistent income as well. So a lot of the men were hugely scared because, you know, their wives would get up and leave because now she has money as well. And this skepticism, of course, was met by even the women. There's like a lot of women who were like, if with this money, it means, you know, our men would go out and start drinking and they would not be in the home. But over time, it's actually brought in a lot of families together because they realize, you know, if you get the money and I get the money, we put in the money together, we can do a lot more as a family. I think on the positive side of the effects of this money, that's what has happened. Like, a lot of people are keen in planning and building and doing their work. But then on the flip side of it is it created a social stratification, like a wealth stratification, like in a place where the general area was relatively equal. You have now one small part of that area becoming more equal than the other part.
So I've read that it has a strange effect where the people in the surrounding villages, sort of the test cases or the, I forget the word they use, but in those cases, their life, their feelings of happiness doesn't stay the same. It goes down. Mm-hmm. Because they're confronted with people who are suddenly have all these things that they don't have, mm-hmm. when they used to be all on the same level. Could you talk about the effects of that?
Sure. Yeah, I mean, so you really have to keep in mind, too, we're talking about what's essentially a family. Like, yes, these are neighbors, but they are really related and really separated by, in this case, in our film, just a stream. It's like kind of nothing, you know, this very small barrier. And so, the people on the side who do not get the money really start to see the world differently. They're not treated at the same at the market as somebody who has money, who shows up and a vendor knows that they're good for it and can pay. The stratification starts to happen. And also in the film, you really see them kind of talking about GiveDirectly as a god-like figure who is chosen to bestow this on one group but not them, and they can't really understand why. What did they do wrong?
I'm also interested in the effect on the economy. I mean, before this happened, people would pay cash, they go to the market, or they barter, they trade, they marketplace is there, and all of a sudden this sector, this one village, has a cell phone and money appears digitally in their lives. Isn't that a major technological shift?
So interestingly, a key reason why GiveDirectly chose Kenya and not only this village is, so mobile money as a technological concept in Kenya and parts of Africa is probably much more advanced than it is in the West.
Okay.
Where essentially your phone number is a bank account. So with your phone number, then using your phone number, someone can just send you money to your phone number, and it's equal to money, more or less, whatever they send. So you could actually even go to the shop or somewhere and when you can send it to the phone number of the shopkeeper, and the shopkeeper gives you actual cash.
So everyone had a phone before the program anyway?
Or? So everybody has a phone number at least.
It's
a SIM card. So everybody has...
Oh, they have the SIM card, but they were given a phone by the program.
So they were given phones by the program just to facilitate them getting the money.
And most people in the villages have phones.
Yeah, they do have phones as well. It was just a means of guaranteeing that whoever they were enrolling in the program is able to access money with a phone. Yeah, with their phone. Yeah.
So, ideally, a UBI is universal, but in this case, it's not universal at all. It's universal mainly within one village. But in your film, you show that there were some members of the village who didn't get it. Could you talk about those cases or that case?
So in our film, we concentrated particularly on the young group. So these three individuals, two of whom, so the experiment, people who are above the age of 15, when the experiment started, we'll start getting the money when they're 18. So we were concentrating on this to individuals who they kind of qualified to get the money when they're 18. So we were tracking the expectation of, you know, how do they feel over a period of time thinking they know this money is going to come. But we were also looking at this other individual who was 18 at the time. So he received the money. So how do they view their future after that? So, you know, they want to go to college and all. They're so excited. This money is going to make that possible. So
there was also a girl who was for some reason excluded.
Yeah, exactly. So the two individuals who were over 15, who we were, you know, we were expecting they were going to get the money. One of them doesn't for a myriad of reasons, technical reasons.
Essentially, GD has a protocol, GiveDirectly has a protocol, and they felt, after investigating, that this young girl did not meet that protocol.
They seem very strict in this charity. Why? What is the purpose of such hard-nosed enforcement?
Well, first of all, they're data-driven as an organization, so I think they kind of live and die by protocol and that sort of level of technicality around what they do and their collection of evidence. But I think for them, it's also kind of become a way where they feel like a village like Kagutu can trust them. If they give them very clear rules, they feel like if they, you know, live up to those rules, they gain credibility within the village. I think, you know, what we see with this girl Jael, though, is really a lack of communication from the organization about whether she'll get the money, and she kind of becomes collateral damage in a lot of ways for something that could be for a greater good, could kind of be with all this transparency and honesty and technicality around it, but it really kind of is an example of someone who falls through the cracks and kind of dealing with this big organization and a human experiment on this scale.
Sam, you've looked at political corruption especially in Kenya itself. What do you think would happen in a program like this if it became policy of the government or an actual UBI within the country, whether foreign funded or domestically funded?
The money, particularly in our experiment, that they were getting is $22.
Right.
$22 out here doesn't feel like a lot of money. But in a village, $22 is a lot of money. It makes a difference on whether you're going to eat or not. So the corruption and other things in terms of how government works, for me, just to think about it makes it feel impossible. But possibility, if such a thing happens, it's a game changer in how the potential to have someone not having to worry about what they're gonna eat or where they're gonna sleep allows them to dream. And I think the greatest positive thing about a universal basic income is the ability to dream. Because if you're just worrying about what to eat, you have no time to dream. However, the beauty of it being run by government is there are structures that exist. So if there's a problem, if there's an issue, or if there's something you need to follow up on, there's accountability. Like, there's a possibility of accountability, which is different for when it's run by a private institution, because where do you take it?
And finally, I'm wondering, for many, many years, all of Africa were made into colonies, and huge amounts of wealth were extracted, which basically built Europe and North America into their current economic status. To have a reversal, even this small, wouldn't it look strange? I mean, would it look as if it's the West that's supporting Africa as opposed to vice versa? In other words, what sort of situation would it be?
it's not. I don't think it's even supposed to be support. It's reparations.
Okay.
It is. It's nothing more, nothing less than what Africa deserves. It's a complicated, long conversation and everything, but it's not a lie that the continent was extracted from. It's not a lie. It continues to be extracted from.
That's right.
And I think continuously having, even speaking about corruption and all these other things that are happening in the continent as an excuse of not giving or paying reparations, it's an excuse. Because let back to like what the beauty of something like UBI is all about, agency. And the agency is for the people. Give them that opportunity to make the choice. Let them have the fights with their corrupt leaders. It's not on you to decide what is good for the people in the continent. The people in the continent know what is good for them.
On those words, let's end this discussion. But thanks so much for talking with me, Lauren and Sam.
Thank you.
Free Money had its world premiere at TIFF and is coming soon. This is Daniel Garber, the Movies, each Saturday morning on CIUT 89.5 FM and on my website, culturalmining.com.
The sound of your city. CIUT 89.5, Toronto.
Well, TIFF is over for the year, and so is our CIUT at TIFF 2022, but the movies will keep showing all year round. Thanks so much for listening. Donna G., how can people find out more about you and your show?
Thanks for asking, Daniel Garber. People can find me at TMTM with Donna G on Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter. And don't forget to listen Sunday afternoons, 1 to 2 p.m. at www.ciut.fm.
Mark Tara, how can people find out more about you and your show?
Thank you, Daniel Garber. Well, you can find me and Rainbow Country right here on CIUT, Tuesdays, 11 p.m.
And you can hear me, Daniel Garber, the Movies, each Saturday morning at 9 a.m. on CIUT 89.5 FM Critic Circle, on Twitter at Cultural Mining, and on my website, culturalmining.com. Thank you so much for tuning in to CIUT for our special coverage of the 47th Toronto International Film Festival. Taking us out, it's Walk On By Isaac Hayes.